UN had no powers under the charter to tell us to join one or the other.
Okay.
The charter says lead the people to their self-government or independence. There are quite a number of people who do not know that there is a 15-page document explaining the meaning of each joining.
Okay.
There was going to be a post-plebiscite conference organized by the United Nations.
Okay.
Question I'm asking you is, has the United Nations organized that post-plebiscite conference to this day? The answer is no. The Fumban conference was neither here nor there. It was an illegal organization. It doesn't conform to this. What this document says, United Nations would convene a conference. United Nations was not at Fumban. Britain was not at Fumban. Page 15. In the event of the Southern and the Northern Cameroon voting in favor of reunification, those entrusted with the responsibility of the affairs of the United Cameroon would, through mutual agreement, specify the manner in which the populations of the two countries would be asked to express their opinion on the federal constitution. So the federal constitution was zero until this opinion is expressed, just like the Maastricht Treaty of which brought Europe together. Unless the people of a country vote accept it, that is when that country becomes a member of the European Union.
So basically you're saying that even the federation that was supposed to, that existed for 12 years was null and void.
It was not even a federation to start with. They called it Federal Republic of Cameroon, but it wasn't a federation since Ahidjo had the power to appoint and dismiss government in Buya. A federation, the government of each state manages its own affairs. It is, by its own constitution, appointed or deposed according to its constitution. That constitution will remain invalid unless it is approved by a referendum of the people of each country. This is what I say. We have been in a lawless state from 1st of October till today. It has been a matter of lawlessness, unconstitutionality, illegality, invalidity from day one till today. And it's going to continue like that until you go back to square one. About it is that the United Nations Charter, Article 76.B, says that the purpose of the trusteeship is to lead the people of the territory to self-rule, self-government. And therefore, once self-government is achieved, trusteeship automatically lapses. It is terminated.
Okay.
Now, in 1958, the British Southern Cameroon achieved self-government. Ipso facto, that terminated the trusteeship, and the British had no longer any function to play in our country, nor the United Nations.
Was there any formality to terminate it?
There is nothing in the trusteeship agreement or trusteeship charter that says there has to be a formality.
Okay.
Now, however, Britain stuck on until 1960.
Okay.
On the 1st of October 1960, Britain published the Southern Cameroon Constitution Order in Council. That Southern Cameroon Order in Council came into effect on 1st of October 1960,
okay,
the same day as the Nigerian Constitution Order in Council came into effect. And that
how are you?
It launched Nigeria
okay.
into independence.
Okay.
Eh? Mm-hmm. Ipso facto, our own Southern Cameroon Constitution Order in Council 1960 launched us into independence.
So orders in council is like our own constitution.
That's our constitution, yes.
Okay.
Now, what happened was that the British did not want our little Southern Cameroon to become a communist controlled country.
Okay.
Our Prime Minister Fonchar was very friendly with Nkrumah in
okay.
Ghana.
Okay.
And in fact, our very first Attorney General, Ori Cross,
okay.
was given to us by Nkrumah of Ghana.
Okay, okay, okay.
So the relationship
was he a Ghanaian?
No, he was a West Indian.
Okay.
Now the relationship between Fonchar and the UPC was very strong.
Okay.
Because when the UPC were chased from French Cameroon,
okay,
and they came out to our own British Cameroon,
okay,
the KNDP formed an alliance with the UPC.
Okay.
When the UPC were again chased out of our country,
mm-hmm.
they went to Ghana,
mm-hmm.
and they created a rapport between Ghana and Fonchar.
Okay, okay.
So when Fonchar became Prime Minister,
okay,
this was a stage was set where if our country became independent, the UPC will come back and use our territory as a haven for the anti-French guerrilla warfare that was going on to overthrow Ahidjo.
Okay, okay.
So, from that perspective, the French did not want British Southern Cameroon to become an independent state and become a haven for the UPC terrorists.
Okay.
Two, the British did not want our country to become independent, and it is in their own records that we will come under the influence of Nkrumah and the Soviets,
okay,
and that will threaten their right to continue exploiting the Cameroon Development Corporation, where they were okay. making millions.
Okay.
Furthermore, they did not want a country like ours to become independent because Nigeria, they had managed to put Nigeria
mm-hmm.
under a stooge, Tafawa Belewa,
okay.
who was a hand-picked agent of the Sultan of Sokoto.
Okay.
I mean, Sadauna of Sokoto.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, with the communists at that place, it was going to be easy to destabilize that arrangement by which Britain stayed in London and ruled Nigeria through Tafawa Belewa.
Okay. Okay.
So, there was a four-point conspiracy against us.
Okay.
Ahidjo and the French,
yeah.
Tafawa and the British.
Okay.
These two were against our independence.
Okay.
So Britain found one excuse or the other to stay on there, perpetuate a trusteeship that had expired by operation of the law.
Okay.
From 1958, Britain was illegal occupying our country. So we found ourselves in a conspiracy. The British refused to go, and I want to emphasize that from that moment, from a legal standpoint, they were illegally occupying our country because trusteeship authority had expired, and it was by trusteeship authority that they were entitled to be in our country.
Okay.
So they hung on and devised a means. In fact, in 1958 June, they circulated a memo at the United Nations stating that our country was ripe for independence.
Okay.
Southern Cameroon was ripe for independence. And since it was being ruled as if it was part of Nigeria,
mm-hmm.
the United Nations must determine that terminate that trusteeship before Nigeria's independence.
Okay. Okay.
Or at the same time with Nigeria's independence.
Okay.
And then they proposed that in any case, since there was some divided opinion as to where some people believe that we should remain part of Nigeria, there would have to be a vote as to whether our independence would be total independence with no connection with Nigeria, mm-hmm. or it should make us independent as part of Nigeria.
Okay.
So those were the alternative Britain proposed in the document of 1958.
Okay.
June.
So the alternatives at that time was only with Nigeria.
In Nigeria.
Okay.
But then, on 1st of January 1960, French Cameroon became independent.
Okay.
Now, before even then, in 1959, Britain realized that the opinion in our place was that which was going to go against absorption into Nigeria.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So they now had to create a scenario where we will vote to join Nigeria. That scenario came by introducing the fact that if we do not join Nigeria, we will have to be made to join the Republic of Cameroon.
So it was
if it became independent.
So it was like a stick and a carrot.
Yeah. So that was the situation.
Okay.
And so when the Republic of Cameroon became, you can see even from the framing of the resolution 1352 about the questions, would you want to join, become independent by joining the future Federation of Independent Federation of Nigeria,
mm-hmm.
or the Federation, I mean the future Independent Republic of Cameroon,
mm-hmm.
because this was in 1959.
Okay.
Republic of Cameroon was not yet born. Nigeria was not yet independent. So the question was framed at that time to take account of the fact that those two countries would become independent.
Okay.
So our independence now was to be linked up with one of them. First, this was ultra virus, because the UN had no powers under the charter to tell us to join one or the other.
Okay.
The charter says lead the people to their self-government or independence.
Okay.
Doesn't say lead them and get them to join one or the other.
Okay.
I think you understand.
Yes. Yes.
Right. However, smartly enough, Foncha, in that time, in any case, Britain started negotiating with Ahijo,
mm-hmm.
to try to make sure Ahijo accepted to absorb us as Nigeria had accepted to absorb us. There are documents where Ahijo clearly stated that in the event of any union between us and them, Southern Cameroon must be responsible for its own internal and external security. That means our army, our navy, our air force would be our problem. It have nothing to do with the Republic of Cameroon. So, when on the 1st of October 1960, the two constitutions, the Southern Cameroon Constitution Order in Council, the Nigerian Constitution Order in Council, came into existence, we became, in fact, independent. Nigeria's independence, Britain accorded it diplomatic recognition, but refused to let anybody recognize ours.
Mm.
So, between 1st of October and 16th December, our government in Buya negotiated with the government of the Republic of Cameroon, and they signed what was called, what we now call the Plebiscite Pact. It was a treaty of proposing a confederacy between the two countries. Now, that was adopted by the United Nations. In that negotiation, the British had no hand in it,
okay.
which means that they themselves recognized us at that time as an independent country capable of getting international treaties and signing them. Once a country is capable of signing international treaties, that country, under international law, is a sovereign and independent country. So with effect from 1st of October 1960, we were a sovereign and independent country, recognized so by Britain, because they, and then by the United Nations, because they adopted what Buya government and Yaounde government signed as a pact. They adopted it and made it as an alternative in the plebiscite manifesto.
Okay.
Now, if you go into the details of what appears in the plebiscite manifesto, You will find there, in the very first, in page 4, it says that if the people of the Southern Cameroon voted to join the Republic of Cameroon, before we even go there, there are quite a number of people who do not know that there is a 15-page document explaining the meaning of each joining.
Okay.
The question was just simple. Do you wish to achieve independence by joining the Independent Republic of Nigeria? B, do you wish to achieve independence by joining the Independent Republic of Cameroon? All right?
Mm-hmm.
These questions were framed in 1959 when neither the two were independent. Right?
Okay.
Now, then it goes on page 4 to explain. If we opted to join the Independent Republic of Cameroon, then the United Nations will convene a post-plebiscite conference.
Okay.
An international conference at which the United Nations, Buya, Yaounde, and the British authorities would sit down and transform what was agreed between Yaounde and Buya, which we call the Plebiscite Pact, into a federal constitution. They will transform these terms, and you can see the terms are stated out there. It's important for us to realize what the terms were. But first, let us see what was to happen. That
okay.
There was going to be a post-plebiscite conference organized by the United Nations.
Okay.
Question I'm asking you is, has the United Nations organized that post-plebiscite conference to this day? The answer is no.
Okay.
Therefore, the implementation of the results of the plebiscite in Southern Cameroon have not been implemented to today.
Okay, so what about the Fumban Conference?
Fumban Conference was neither here nor there. It was an illegal organization. It doesn't conform to this. What this document says, United Nations would convene a conference. United Nations was not at Fumban. Britain was not at Fumban.
Okay.
So that was a private arrangement which Ahijo duped our people. And not only duped our people, he didn't force them. I remember asking Mukong, after I saw this document in 1990, I was a law student when all this was going on. Mm-hmm. It was in 1990 that I found this document in the archives of the UN. I presented this to Mr. Mukong. I said, Mukong, is this what you people voted for in the plebiscite? He said, yes. I said, but here it says the United Nations would convene a post-plebiscite conference. So what were you going to Fumban for? Mm-hmm. He couldn't answer me. Justice Ndeli, who is calling, he was a lawyer, he was a legal advisor to the CPNC, and they went to Fumban. These are lawyers. They went to Fumban, whereas this document says it's the United Nations conference which was to work out this thing. I would say some type of elementary spirit was used to spellbind these people, and they went to Fumban, and all they did was they got there, there were disagreement as to what the constitutional setup should be, but whatever it is, the main thing I'm saying is that as long as there was no United Nations conference, what we voted for has not been implemented.
So that union was an illegal union, and therefore whatever developed after that would have probably come
out. I would say it had no relevance to this.
Okay.
You can say preliminary discussions.
Okay.
Eh? And there was total disagreement. Foncha, in his own distinct, said they were to meet again, and they never met again. And in any case, this was all pure bluff, a facade, just fooling people. Because in May 1961, De Gaulle got Ahijo to enact what they call the Federal Republic of Cameroon. A law of Yaounde. May the British were still in our country. Yaounde passes a law which was to be applied on our country. It is not only illegal, but it is extraterritorial. A law is only legal when it's applied within the territorial limits of that country. But when a country takes upon itself to pass a law which will affect another country, that law is null and void, ab initio. Yet that is what was imposed on us on 1st of October. Instead of what this thing says, we are supposed to go and negotiate a constitution. That constitution will remain invalid unless it is approved by a referendum of the people of each country.
Ratified by?
By referendum.
Okay.
It is stated there in page 15. In the event of the Southern and the Northern Cameroon voting in favor of reunification, those entrusted with the responsibility of the affairs of the United Cameroon would, through mutual agreement, specify the manner in which the populations of the two countries would be asked to express their opinion on the federal constitution. So the federal constitution was zero until this opinion is expressed. It's just like the Maastricht Treaty which brought Europe together. Unless the people of a country vote accept it, that is when that country becomes a member of the European Union.
So basically you're saying that even the federation that was supposed to, that existed for 12 years was null and void.
It was not even a federation to start with. They called it Federal Republic of Cameroon. But it wasn't a federation, since Ahidjo had the power to appoint and dismiss government in Buya. A federation, the government of each state manages its own affairs. It is, by its own constitution, appointed or deposed according to its constitution. But this one here, does the president of the United States appoint governors and dismiss governors in the... No, they are elected according to the constitutions of the each state in the United States. That is what we call federalism. The government of a federated state must be independent of the federal government. But this one, Article 37, 39 of that constitution, gives the president, Ahidjo, the power to dismiss the prime minister and appoint the prime minister of Buya or the Republic of Cameroon. And that's how they dismissed Bobejua and appointed Muna, or got Foncha to go over to Yaounde. And we're still going to come to that. But what I want to say, that federal thing, whatever, even if it was the right one, was null and void insofar as it was not done in accordance with the procedure set out in what we voted. You see, anything, no matter how right it is, once it is done in the wrong way, amounts to doing the wrong thing.
Okay, I'm going to ask you a question before you continue. Can you express the importance of law in the management of state and world affairs? Why is there a need that these laws have to be followed, even and you call on what happened after that?
If you don't follow the law, you are in chaos. Absolute chaos. Because you can't tell anybody he's wrong. Wrong by what means? He must say such and so law says you shouldn't do this. That's why you are wrong. But if there is if you don't follow the law, it means you are lawless. This is what I say. We have been in a lawless state from 1st of October. Till today, it has been a matter of lawlessness, unconstitutionality, illegality, invalidity from day one till today. And it's going to continue like that until you go back to square one and follow what we voted for.
Now, you're going to mention something about the different conditions of joining of the two organizations.
Yes. Now, people do not know. They just read. In fact, I was surprised even that the people who are arguing cases at the ICJ over the Bakassi, Nigeria's Attorney General never had even a copy of this. When I met him, I said, now, have you studied the two alternatives and the way you are arguing your case? How is it? He said, what is the two alternatives? I said, the manifesto of the United Nations, 15-page manifesto of the plebiscite. He said, they've never seen it. I believe they are much more thorough than our team, Cameroon team. And I believe that the Cameroon team doesn't have a copy of this. They may have got it later on, because when they filed their case at the International Court of Justice, they said, they acknowledge that Cameroon has annexed British Southern Cameroon. But that they did this because British Southern Cameroon, in the plebiscite, voted that Cameroon should annex them. Now, by quoting that plebiscite, you submit this document to the International Court of Justice for interpretation.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
The lawyers there will now take this plebiscite, the plebiscite manifesto, and the judges will look at it. And Nigeria already has it, and they are waiting to trap Cameroon at the time when they're doing the oral arguments.
Okay.
They are going to point out to Cameroon, this is what the plebiscite said. The powers which could be exercised by the federal authority. Now, if you look at page 13 of the manifesto, it states out the powers which the federal government has right to interfere in.
Mm-hmm.
It states them, there are only eight.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Only eight subjects where the federal government may legislate in.
You mean the federal government of the two Cameroons?
Yes, that's why I call it a confederacy.
Okay.
The confederacy, the Cameroon and Ambazonian confederacy, the authorities of the confederacy may legislate in only these eight matters.
And what are the eight again?
They are public freedom, nationality, national defense, foreign affairs, higher education, immigration and immigration, federal budget, post and telecommunications. Those are the only areas. Now, let us assume that the legislation of a state of Buya conflicts with their legislation here.
Meaning that they want something else and Buya wants
something
else.
That's to say different. The federal.
Right.
Federal legislation in these matters conflicts. Okay. It is said. There is where the federal legislation will prevail.
Okay.
In the event of a conflict, it's written there, it will prevail.
On those eight?
On these eight.
Okay.
Outside these eight, it is written there, in non-federal matters, the states have exclusive competence. So there is not going to be any place for conflict of authority in non-federal matters.
And what are some of those non-federal
matters? Now, let me bring them out to you. You compare this with what we had with Nigeria. This is what the federal authorities would have exclusive competence. You look at them.
I will get them here.
Now, aviation, external borrowing, currency, and coinage. You use your currency in this one?
No. No.
Now, copyright, customs, and excise. Do you have customs and excise in that one?
No.
All right. Defense and police. That's the defense is where that's what you have in that one, which there is concurrency between us and them on defense. Then you have external affairs, external trade. Nothing in that one about external trade.
Mm-hmm.
Immigration and immigration concurrent, incorporation and regulation of companies, insurance, shipping, mining and minerals, including oil and natural gas. That was a federal matter. Mm-hmm. In our own, it's not mentioned.
See, we don't even have this knowledge.
Well, naval, military, and air forces. Is it mentioned here?
No.
Now, nuclear energy, patents and trade, post and telecommunication is mentioned there. That's where we have any concurrent jurisdiction with Yaounde. Trunk roads, company taxes, wireless broadcasting, and so on. These are things exclusively for the states. Then go add more. These ones here, antiquities, arms and ammunition. Did you hear it there? In the one with Cameroon?
No.
Bankruptcy, census, commercial and industrial monopolies, combines and trust, labor, industrial relations, all this added to these other things would be within the exclusive jurisdiction of Buya, except those other eight where Buya authority can be supplanted by the federal authority. So we had a choice between being absorbed into Nigeria, where we have nothing. In fact, as far as Nigeria is concerned, once we got into Nigeria, we would be able to deal only with primary education, cooperatives, and agriculture. But in this other one, it is the reverse. We had everything. That's why it was a confederacy between Cameroon and Ambazonia. Now, our people, of course, that thing was signed between Buya and Yaounde on the 16th of December, 1960. The United Nations adopted it and put it on this plebiscite manifesto as the second alternative. That is what our people voted for. The second alternative being a confederacy of sovereign nations, just like the European Union, where you have a European Parliament there which coordinates and harmonizes policies within European countries on things like immigration, agriculture, defense, and all this. That's what is happening in Europe. But nobody goes to tell Britain how many soldiers he should have, how many air forces, and so on. So each one has his business. Yeah, they have their customs and excise. Each one has his currency and so on. That was how it was supposed to be. And that's what we were presented with by the United Nations, and that is what we voted for. Question is that what we got? No.
No, absolutely.
So we voted for this, and all we are asking is what we voted for should be given to us. They proposed it, we accepted it. That is what they call a social contract between us and the international community.
So what you were challenging in 1985 I know in 1985 you wrote the social order.
In 1985.
Right. So you
in 1985, I had not seen this document.
Okay.
I was only dealing with an interpretation of the law of 1984/01.
Okay.
I call it the dissolution law, because that law dissolved the illegal union between Buya and Yaounde. Now, I was asking Ahijo, please comply with the letter and spirit of that law by limiting your administration, the administration of the Republic of Cameroon, to the territorial boundaries of the Republic of Cameroon. And let us run our own affairs. That is the question for which I'm now in exile. Interpret, comply with your own law. He promulgated it.
You mean Paul Biya?
Yes. Paul Biya asked him, comply. That is why we're asking them, comply with your law. Get out of our country according to your law. Of course, they didn't intend it. But God is the one God took us into that slavery. And God is bringing us out whether they like it or not. When did you imagine a government, they sit down and pass a law, believing that they are now trying to erase what they call Anglophone problem? There should be no trace that there ever existed another country. Little did they know, God was trying to get them to revive the sovereignty of that country. Because when two people form a partnership, and that partnership is called Ambe Chotu Partnership, when it is dissolved and Ambe is re-establishing a business of his, the partnership dies.
Mm-hmm.
Automatically, Chotu is independent of that. It's like a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
When you divorce a marriage, one man does not remain married. They become all free.
Mm-hmm.
Now, bring the international complicity in this whole thing?
Yes.
And then, and therefore obligation?
Now, the international complicity in the matter is this. First, we accuse Britain of a breach of an international obligation. Their duty was to lead us onto independence. Now, what happened was that when the time came for implementing what we voted for, Britain, from the archives, are only discovered in 1991 when they became declassified, because there are secret documents till 30 years after. 1991, they were not open for the public. That's where I discovered the most startling revelations, that the colonial office talking about us, our country, like a cattle ranch. That Ian MacLeod, the colonials, British colonial secretary in 1961, sold our country like a cattle ranch. The records are there, the names, we're talking about sell our country like a cattle ranch to De Gaulle to annex to French Cameroon. Why did they do that? The records show that because Foncha, who was our prime minister, was very, very friendly with Nkrumah of Ghana. The fear was that our country will come under the influence of Nkrumah and the Soviets. And British interest in the CDC would be at risk. So it means that in exchange for Britain to continue having CDC, we had to be sold to the Republic of Cameroon, to the goal to annex the Republic of Cameroon, because if we were independent, CDC would be, Britain would lose the CDC. So that was what human rights lawyers call the most sophisticated slave trade deal done under United Nations cover. But the truth about it is this: the God who got us into this servitude is the one bringing us out. I feel confident about it, because when our people started having these pro-independence riots, like in Bamenda, usually, where they burned a whole police station and calling for singing home again, trying to get Saint Dispush back out of our country. In response, the Cameroon government enacted a law of the United Republic of Cameroon, law number 84/01. They, in the debates for it, they said the question of calling this thing the United Republic of Cameroon gives the impression that there are two countries that are united. We should therefore make sure this united is out, so that there should be no trace that there was another country. Little did they know that the outcome of reinventing the Republic of Cameroon is that legally you have also reinvented the sovereignty of the other country. So the law which they intended to wipe us out is the law that dissolved the illegal union. That is the work of God.